Good morning, everyone. That was an enthusiastic morning. Lovely to see you and to welcome you to our service today. I've got just a few announcements. Just to remind you that next Sunday is the beginning of our summer timetable. So from next Sunday through all of July and August, we will be meeting at 11 a.m. instead of 11:30. So if you could remember that, otherwise maybe a few heads will turn as you walk in at 25 past. So 11 a.m. And then just to remind parents that JAM continues during the summer months. That will be during the morning service as usual. And then to thank those who sent back their returns for the voting for the committee members, and just announce those who have been re-elected or elected to the committee, and they are as follows: Mr. Stephen Aiken, Johnny Bain, Alan Brownlee, Robert Dobbin, Alistair Glover, Neville Glover, Dermot Kelly, Mrs. Deirdre Kennedy, Geoffrey Kirk, Martin Maggiore, Mrs. Christine McCabe, Raymond McClurg, John McKeown, Robert Nixon, Andrew Orr, Paul Orr, Mark Scott, and Martin Scott. And we do indeed trust, as they serve us over the next 3 years, that they will know the Lord's blessing, and the Lord will give them wisdom in all the decisions we have to make concerning our fabric and finances here in Kilmore Church family. We indeed commend them to the Lord. As we come to worship, we remind ourselves of some words from 1 Peter. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. It's kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of salvation that's ready to be revealed in the last time. This is the God we come to worship, and we do so in song, in prayer, and meditation upon the Word of God. So let's join together in praise as we approach God in our worship. We have come into this house and gathered in his name to worship him. Let's stand to sing.
Come into his house and gathered in his name to worship him. We have come into his house and gathered in his name to worship him. We have come into his house and gathered in his name to worship Christ the Lord. Worship him, Christ. Concentrate on him and worship him. So forget about yourself and concentrate on him and worship Christ the Lord. Worship him, Christ the Lord. Let us lift up holy hands and magnify his name. Magnify his name and worship him.
You may wonder why we are using pipe music this morning. Well, the funeral service this afternoon, or I should say the Thanksgiving service, is at 2:30. So our service this morning will be slightly shorter, but we have had to rearrange a lot of things in the building in preparation for the service. So that's why we don't have the praise band and all our usual paraphernalia up around the front. We're having the Lindsay Chorale coming to join us this afternoon to lead us in singing. So we needed to prepare all of that. So just listen very carefully as we sing from our recorded music. It has been recorded by our praise band in the past that we've used. Let's come to God in prayer. We come before you, O God. You are great, you are marvellous, you are worthy of praise. We come and we recognise that you are holy, you are thrice holy. And we thank you for the privilege of coming into this place and gathering in your name to worship you. We worship you, God, our Heavenly Father, because you have made us, you created us. You want us to have fellowship with you. We come and we acknowledge that you are the great God. You are also the merciful God. Because in your love and in your mercy, you saw our need. And you sent the Lord Jesus Christ into the world to be our Savior. We worship you, Lord Jesus. Because you are worthy of all praise. Because though you were in heaven's glory, there with the Father and the Holy Spirit, you left all of that to come and to live on earth, to be despised and rejected, to be maligned, to be falsely tried and accused and crucified, all for the sake of our salvation, because you loved us so much. We thank you that through your death, we can be forgiven. But we thank you that death could not hold you, and through your resurrection, we have an eternal hope. So help us as we worship today to be mindful of all of these things. We never take them for granted. That the grace of God that drew salvation's plan and brought that down to man in Christ, that we are eternally grateful. And you are worthy of all our praise. We worship you, Holy Spirit, sent from God the Father and the Son to live within us, to convict us of our sin, to convert us, and then to empower us to be the children of God in this our day and generation. So as we meet in this place, inspire our worship. Help us as we sing. Give us faith as we pray. And then give us the determination to live for our God in a world that needs to hear about the Lord Jesus Christ. So hear our prayer as we come in and through the precious name of Jesus, our Savior and Lord, who taught us to pray. And so we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Before the young folk go out, I think there are one or two, go out to jam. I know that the end of this week is the end of term, and we know that you have been working hard all year. You're looking forward to the break. But as we do so, let us remember that God never goes on a holiday. He's always with us, and we can always come and talk to him in prayer, and we can bring to him all our needs and our concerns, and we can come and talk to him about anything. And so as we come into the summer holiday time, We do come in prayer and ask the Lord to be with you, that you will enjoy the summer holidays, praying too that you'll not forget about God, but that you'll come to him and talk to him on a regular basis and come and join with us here in worship. So we're going to sing a song that talks about leaving things in God's hands. So often we try to do things in our own strength, and then whenever things don't go so well, we wonder why. And that's because if we leave God out of things, then we're trying to do things our way instead of God's way. And we're trying to do it in whatever physical strength we have or mental strength we have. And we need to depend on God because he made us. He knows us through and through. He knows what's best for us. And so we can come and we can lay our lives before him and say, Lord, be with me, strengthen me, forgive me, and help me to live for you. So we're going to stand and sing, Father, I place into your hands the things I cannot do.
Father, I place into your hands the things that I can't do. Father, I place into your hands the times that I've been through. Father, I place into your hands the way that I should go. For I know I always can trust you. Father, I place into your hands my friends and family. Father, I place into your hands the things that trouble me. Father, I place into your hands the person I would be. For I know I always can trust you. Father, we love to seek your face, we love to hear your voice. Father, we love to sing your praise and in your name rejoice. Father, we love to walk with you and in your presence rest, for we know we always can trust you. Father, I want to be with you and do the things you do. Father, I want to speak the words that you are speaking to. Father, I want to love the ones that you will draw to you. For I know that I am one.
Lord, we are so thankful that you are a God who listens to us and hears our every need. We ask that you would answer our prayers in line with your perfect will. Lord, we pray for an immediate ceasefire and end to war in Ukraine. We pray for all those who are grieving the loss of loved ones and those who are suffering from injuries. We pray for your healing hand on them. We thank you for all the medical staff who continue to offer support in challenging conditions. Lord, we also pray for those who have fled the conflict in Ukraine and other parts of the world. We pray that you would guide them to safety and that they would receive the humanitarian and medical assistance they need, both now and in the months ahead. We also pray for charities such as Christian Aid, Tear Fund and Hungarian Reformed Church Aid, that they would be able to help those most in need. We pray for the people of Afghanistan, which has been devastated by the earthquake last week. Lord, so many have lost loved ones. We pray that you would bring them comfort and that they would know your love. We pray for healing for those who are injured and that aid would reach those in need as soon as possible. We pray those who have lost their homes can find shelter and get access to clean drinking water as soon as possible. Lord, as our young people see out the last days of school term this week, we thank you that COVID has not caused any major disruptions to school life. We thank you for all the members of staff who work in schools. We know it can be a challenging yet rewarding job. And we pray that they enjoy some much needed rest over the summer holidays. We also pray for our young people. Be with those who may struggle without the formal structure of the school day, and for parents who find it difficult to juggle childcare and work. Over the summer, there may be opportunities for our young people to join mission trips. We pray that you would keep them safe and that you would use their skills and abilities to meet both the spiritual and physical needs of others. We pray for the cost of living crisis and for families who are struggling to buy the basics. We pray that energy prices would fall to a more sustainable level and that government support would be directed to those most in need. We pray for food banks. As their demand increases, we pray that those who can will support them. And Lord, we pray that you would work in our hearts and that by following your example, we would give to those who need some additional help. Lord, we pray for our church family here in Kilmore. Comfort those who are grieving the loss of a loved one, who may be ill or feeling lonely. We pray you would surround them with your loving arms. Lord, prompt us to reach out to them, whether that would be a phone call, a visit, or even just a text. Finally, Lord, we have heard this week about the rising COVID infections in the UK. We pray that any new strain would be less severe and that the vaccines would continue to be effective. We pray that hospitalisations would be kept to a minimum and that we would not need to go back to the restrictions of the past. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank Geoffrey for leading us in those prayers. Before we come to God's word, we're going to sing again, and it's based on a psalm. It's the song, "As the deer pants for the water, so my soul longs after you." So we stand to sing.
Pants for the water, so my soul longs after you. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit.
Let's come to God in prayer. Father God, we pray that as we come to your word now, that it will be fresh to us. It'll not be just words on a page, but rather your Holy Spirit will enliven them and appoint them to our hearts. So may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable to you, our Lord, our Rock, and our Redeemer. Amen. Last week, whenever we were looking at the whole aspect of the tabernacle worship and how the blood of Christ was much more important, it was greater, it was supreme in everything that was happened. And so in the first part of chapter 10, we have almost a reaffirming of that for us. And I just want to point out a couple of verses from that chapter 10. Verse 3 and 4, it's talking about how the sacrifices were an annual reminder of sins. If you remember, we were talking about how the tabernacle, you had that annual event where the high priest went in and he offered sacrifice for his own sins and then for the sins of the people, and he would then sprinkle the blood on the mercy seat. But as that happened year after year, the writer to the Hebrews is saying that was just a constant reminder that the people were sinners. A constant reminder that their sins had not been completely covered over in that sense, because the sins were still there. They were ritually clean in the eyes of the Lord, but their conscience, as we discovered, was not cleansed. And so it was always there in the back of their mind that they were sinners. And this sacrifice year after year reminded them that their sins needed to be atoned for. But the writer to the Hebrews then wants to point them again to the fact that Jesus came, and what he has done on the cross is so important. It was a once and for all sacrifice. And so in verse 10, we read, "We have been made holy through the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once for all." All the sacrificial system of the Old Testament was ongoing and ongoing, year in and year out. The various sacrifices for sins, and then the yearly atonement, the Day of Atonement. But he says Jesus has accomplished what the old system could not do. And in the light of that, how do we live as believers? And so that's why we're going to concentrate today on verses 19 to 25 of chapter 10, but we're going to read from verse 19 through to the end of the chapter. And Richard has recorded that for us.
"Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain that is his body, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience, and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. If we deliberately keep on sinning after we have received the knowledge of the truth, no sacrifice for sins is left, but only a fearful expectation of the judgment and of raging fire that will consume the enemies of God. Anyone who rejected the law of Moses died without mercy on the testimony of two or three witnesses. How much more severely do you think someone deserves to be punished who has trampled the Son of God underfoot, who has treated as an unholy thing the blood of the covenant that sanctified them, and who has insulted the Spirit of grace? For we know who said, 'It is mine to avenge, I will repay,' and again, 'The Lord will judge his people.' It is a dreadful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. Remember those early days after you had received the light, when you endured in a great conflict full of suffering. Sometimes you were publicly exposed to insult and persecution. At other times you stood side by side with those who were so treated. You suffered along with those in prison and joyfully accepted this confiscation of your property, because you knew that you yourselves had better and lasting possessions. So do not throw away your confidence. It will be richly rewarded. You need to preserve so that when you have done the will of God, you will receive what he has promised. For in just a little while, he who is coming will come and will not delay. But my righteousness, one will live in faith. And I take no pleasure in one who shrinks back. But we do not belong to those who shrink back and are destroyed, but to those who have faith and are saved.
Amen, and may God add his blessing to the reading of his word. I wonder, have you ever maybe been in a hotel and you got your wee card? No keys anymore. The wee card. I have great fun with them. Not that we go to hotels very often, but I have great fun with them. They don't always work for me. When you put them in, and yeah, it's a wee bit like dipping your ginger snap in the tea, and you know, sometimes the ginger snap falls off. But you try this key. Well, the one that's maybe a little bit better is one that you just sort of hold up against, and you walk and you just tap, and hopefully the door opens. You're hoping that that'll happen, that you will gain entrance into the room that you've paid for without any difficulty. The writer of the Hebrews here is telling us that we have confidence, as it were, to use our key card to get us into the presence of God. It'll never fail. Why? Because that key card is Jesus Christ. He is the one who gets us into the presence of God. We can't get there ourselves. We already discovered in earlier on in the chapter that the blood of bulls and goats do not take away sins. And so if we have sins, we cannot enter into the kingdom of God. We cannot enter into the presence of God. So we need someone who can gain access for us. And Jesus is that person. And so in the next couple of verses 19 through to actually 22, we have this wonderful hope and assurance. We have confidence through cleansing. Confidence through cleansing. Let's remind ourselves again of the verses. It says, therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain, that is his body, and since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water. That is confidence through cleansing. And in those verses, we have discovered that there is the new way. This new way is Jesus Christ. Beforehand, whenever they wanted to enter into the presence of God in the time of the tabernacle, they had to go through a process. It was the priests who sacrificed on their behalf. They didn't do the sacrificing. The priest did it. And then it was the high priest on their behalf who went into the Holy of Holies. The writer says we have a new way, and that is Jesus Christ. As we have been discovered over the last number of weeks about the whole of Hebrews, the writer is constantly wanting us to look to Jesus. Look to Jesus, because he is the one who can do what we cannot do. He is the one who has opened up the way And it's a new way. It wasn't through a sacrificial system that had to be repeated year after year after year. It's a new way. It's not ritual. It's not law. It's not trying to do the best you could and offering the best you could. Because at the end of the day, it was never really good enough. So this is a new way, but it's also a living way. Because Jesus Christ, who was the sacrifice, and he, the high priest, who sacrificed himself upon the cross, is alive. He's not dead. It is a living way. It means it's still alive. It's still the way to go. If we want to be in the presence of God, we go to Jesus because he has opened up the way, and the offer to be in God's presence is still there. It's an ongoing living thing because Jesus Christ is alive. Because he's alive, he can offer us life and he can offer us eternal life. This new way is a living way. It's a vibrant way. It's still ongoing. But it's also a costly way. Because it says, by a new and living way opened up for us through the curtain, that is his body. Jesus Christ had to sacrifice himself for us to become children of God. And so often we seem to almost forget it. It was costly. He gave up his very life for you and for me. He didn't die because he had sinned. He died because we sinned. He died to bring us into the presence of God, but it was costly. Because think, not only did he suffer the pain of the cross, and that must have been horrendous. He was in agony. But we have to remember there was another dimension. There was the Father turning his back. And so we have that cry of dereliction on the cross. My God, why have you forsaken me? That close relationship was broken at that point as God turned his back on the sin that his son was carrying. It was costly. His blood was spilt. His body broken. And he says to us, we can be in the very presence of the living God because of Jesus. And that's why he says, let us draw near to God with sincere heart. We don't come before God willy-nilly. We don't come with God with an offhand attitude. We come recognizing what God has done for us in Christ. He says, let us draw near. Yes, confidently draw near, but come with sincerity in our hearts. That means that we are really, really earnest about our worship. As we come and we thank God for what he's done, we thank Jesus for dying on the cross for us, and we come with sincerity. But he also says, come with full assurance that faith brings. Whenever we trust in what Christ has done, we don't need to be afraid because we have the assurance that what he says he has done, what he says he will continue to do, and what he says he will bring to fruition. And all of that we have in the picture of the tabernacle here, of the sprinkled blood. Because the blood was shed, there is forgiveness for sins. but also the conscience is cleansed. And we also have a picture here, probably, of our bodies washed with pure water, thinking of baptism. Because baptism is a symbol of washing, the need for the washing away of our sins. So he says, let's come. Let's come to God with sincerity, with assurance, with our guilty conscience being cleansed. That's what our confidence is based upon. We do not come before God in our own righteousness. We do not come before God saying, Lord, you really, really could not do without me. I'm such a wonderful person. You really would miss out if you didn't have me in your family. No, no. We come with humility and we say, Lord, thank you that you want me. Sinner as I am. Thank you that you died for me. Thank you that you have brought me into the kingdom of God. A new way. A living way, a costly way. But then we move on and we discover that there is hope through faithfulness. It says, let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. Let us hold on unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. In my car, I have a very annoying little thing that appears on my dial in front of me as I'm driving along. Now, I couldn't get a picture of the exact how it appears in my car, and it would be wrong for me to try and take a picture of it as I'm driving along. But here's the idea. Lane divergence warning. And around these roads, I do it all the time. I am across the white line to avoid the ruts. But every so often, from here to Crossgar, I will have this thing appearing numerous times, two lines, and it's in red and it's telling me that I'm not keeping between the lanes. I'm not on the right side. I'm swerving slightly over the line, except on the corners, and then I end up in a hole somewhere. But it's a warning not to go outside the white line. And then if you're driving in Belfast, you've got lanes maybe on both sides of you, so sometimes it tells you that you're going to the left and you're going to the right, and stay in the middle. It's very similar in our Christian lives. It's very easy for us to swerve slightly away from the truth. Something happens and we nearly come to God and say, well, it's your fault. I'm in this predicament, Lord, because it's your fault. None to do with me not trusting God in the first place. No, 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 no. It's God's fault. We swerve away from the truth. From the path that God has guided us. When we get to chapter 12, we'll discover that there's a race that we have to persevere in, and we're to throw off anything that so easily entangles, in other words, can cause us to swerve. He says, let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess. What is that hope? That hope is that Christ came, Christ died, Christ has been raised, and Christ is coming back. That is the hope. And because he's done all that, we have a sure and certain home that by trusting in him, we are going to be with him. And that is something we should profess. Each one of you who came to be a full member in the congregation professed your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. That was one of the questions. You professed before people that you were a believer. But that's something that is ongoing.
It's not something that you say on the 23rd of July 1940, whatever it was, I put my trust in the Lord, I'm on my way to heaven, hallelujah. I'm not doing very much sense, but, you know, I'm going there. It's an ongoing thing. So we are to hold on unswervingly to that hope. Why? Because the one who promised us that he would forgive us, he would walk with us, and he would go before us, and indeed would come back for us. Never fibs. He never lies. It's a promise. And therefore we should rejoice in that. And because Christ has said it, then we should want to walk with him day by day and not wander off. I'm sure you have been in a shopping centre or maybe just a large supermarket, and all of a sudden you find this little child in distress. And you can see that they just don't know where they are or what's happening, and they're gurning their eyes out. Where's my mommy? I can't find my mommy. Where's my daddy? Because, you see, they have been distracted. Something on a shelf, maybe a toy, one of those things that depress and that makes noise for 5 minutes. And yet it's fascinated, and then turns round, and where are the parents? And the parents are busy shopping, and they forget maybe sometimes that the wee one's there. But the child gets so distressed because it hasn't held on to the trolley or held on to the parent's hand, and so it gets itself in distress. You see, we need to make sure that we're walking with, holding on, yes, but in Jesus' case, he never lets us go. He has promised never to leave us nor forsake us even to the end of the world. And that is something that should keep us going. Hope through faithfulness. And then finally, action through fellowship. The writer says, "And let us consider how we may spur one another on towards love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching." Well, let's start with the last two words. The day approaching is the time whenever Christ returns, whenever the kingdom of God will be fulfilled. Now, we don't know when that's going to happen, but it's approaching. We're definitely nearer to it than we were yesterday. So what are we supposed to be doing as believers, if we say we're believers? Well, for a start, we should be a people of encouragement. Our middle name should be Barnabas. We should be encouraging one another in the faith, spurring one another on towards love and good deeds. Now, he's talking to believers here. He's not saying that good deeds is going to get you to heaven. But what he is saying is, if you claim to be a believer, then your life should be filled with love and good deeds. Action. That's what the Christian life is about. It's not sitting around waiting for the Lord to return. Sitting on your laurels and saying, "I'm saved, hallelujah. Now, Lord, come back and get me." No, it is saying that we should be encouraging one another to love and good deeds. It's also saying that we should be fellowshipping one another. Now, fellowship sometimes is interpreted as a wee cup of tea and a biscuit. That's not always fellowship. Fellowship can be part of that, but it's not fellowship. Fellowship is whenever we sit down and we talk with our brothers and sisters in the Lord and we encourage one another in the faith. And we can only do that whenever we meet together. Now, the thing that sometimes makes me despondent about our church family here is the number of times I look down and folk aren't here. It's almost, in some cases, it's almost a take it or leave it sort of thing. But it says we ought to be meeting one another, not just to be seen to be there, not just to get the tick in the rule book, but rather we want to be together. We want to share with one another. We want to be in worship with one another. The General Assembly was this past number of days. And I was playing for some of the worship. And to sit at the front of that building at the organ and hear the voices behind me raised in praise, it was amazing. In heaven, it'll be perfect. But I'm telling you, the sound that was coming from some of the people was absolutely wonderful. We worship together, and in so doing, we encourage one another. So we shouldn't be giving up meeting together, because not meeting becomes a habit, and the pandemic has actually proven that. If we get out of the habit of doing something, it's very difficult to get back into it. And if the habit hasn't been great before the pandemic, as far as church attendance is concerned, it's not going to improve afterwards. So let's continue to meet together. Let's share together. Let's encourage one another in the faith. Because in so doing, we will be built up so that whenever those difficult times come, we're ready for them. And we can then depend upon our faith. We can say to the Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief. But the faith is there. So the writer to the Hebrews is saying, you know, what a wonderful privilege it is to be a Christian. We have confidence through cleansing. Jesus has done it all by dying and rising and going to heaven. We are cleansed. We are right before God because of what Christ has done. We have hope in our everyday living as believers because Jesus Christ has promised and he's faithful. Our hope is not a wish. It's something certain because Christ has said it. And because of all that, because of the confidence through cleansing and the hope through faithfulness, then there ought to be in every believer's life action through fellowship. Wouldn't it be lovely to see that here every week, where we enjoy meeting together? Our lips are filled with praise. When we come in prayer, we come with confidence in a God who does not fail. And we're encouraging one another, looking out for one another, loving one another. Because that is what a Christian family, church family, is all about. And I would just love that the Spirit of God would move in such a way that would be our experience here in Kilmore. Let's be praying that it will be. Amen. Let's join in prayer. Father God, we thank you for Jesus. We thank you for his sacrifice. We thank you for the hope he brings. May we be encouraged this day by your word. Help us to come with enthusiasm and in fellowship, that we will build one another up in the faith so that others will see that Jesus is real. He changes lives. He gives us something worth living for. And he is alive forevermore. So hear our prayer, for we pray in his name. Amen. Our last hymn is one of talking about God's grace and how amazing it is and how Jesus has reached down to us and become our Savior. Let's stand to sing. In the grace of God to be his people in our community, in our families, in our workplaces, or wherever we go. So let's bless one another with the words of the grace as we say, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.